Hi everyone, I'm Simon Willison, and I've spent the last 4 years building tools for data analysis and exploration on top of SQLite. I'm going to give you a tour of them. Let's start with some data. The Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission released a dataset of manatee carcass recovery locations in Florida, dating all the way back to 1974, and they make that data available as a CSV file. Here's that CSV file. I'm going to import that into a SQLite database using a tool I wrote called sqlite-utils. So I type sqlite-utils, insert, I'll call the database manatees.db, table called locations, and in goes that CSV file. Oh, it wants me to add -csv. So I do that, and now I have a file called manatees.db. It's 2.8 megabytes. And I can do things like I can ask for its schema. It's got a table called locations with a bunch of columns in. I can also run some queries against it. Let's do select county, comma, rep date. From locations limit 10. There we go. That comes out as JSON. If I add -t, I get that's a table. I can even have fancy formats and say things like -fmt-latex to get out LaTeX representation of that, ready for me to paste into my academic paper. Let's do something a bit more visual. So I'm going to launch my dataset tool against that SQLite database. So this is now running a local web server. And if I click on here, I get a web interface and I can start browsing through that table. Looks like a table of data. But one of my favorite ways of exploring a dataset that I'm new to is using something called faceting. So here's a dataset suggesting that the interesting facets here might be the month, the sex, the decode, or the mortality. Let's click on mortality. So now this is showing me for these 13,500 sadly deceased manatees, what were the most common causes of mortality for them? So unsurprisingly, it was watercraft collisions, was a good fifth of them. Natural cold stress, human-related floodgate and canal lock is the least common, but it looks interesting. So I can click through that. Now it's suggesting that I facet by county. I can see that Miami-Dade County is the most dangerous county to be if you're a manatee and you're worried about getting trapped in a floodgate or canal lock. So we're already beginning to learn things about this data just through data firing it up in dataset and starting to apply facets. Everything you can see in dataset, you can export back out again. Here we've got 254 rows where mortality was that canal lock. And if we click on CSV, we can get back just that subset of the data as CSV. I can click on JSON to get it as JSON, which is ready to be imported into other programming environments. But I can also click View and Edit SQL and see the actual SQL query that was run to produce those results. And I can edit it too. I'm going to say, you know what, I just want the T-length, state, county, these columns here for those rows. And if I hit Run SQL, I now get back that subset of the data. And again, I can export that out as CSV and I can get that back as JSON. Now, if you're thinking, hang on, does this mean that I can construct a SQL query in my own client-side JavaScript and then run it against the server via this URL here? The answer is yes, you can, and it's not actually nearly as bad an idea as it sounds. This might look like a SQL injection vulnerability as a feature, and indeed it is, but it's completely safe for a couple of reasons. Firstly, the database file itself is opened in read-only mode, so there is nothing that you can do here that would modify that data as it's stored on disk. And secondly, all of these SQL queries have a hard time limit of a second applied to them. If a query takes longer than that, it terminates with an error. But let's clean this data up a little bit. This table isn't necessarily in the best possible state. For that, I'm going to switch back to SQLite-utils again. So SQLite-utils has a number of tools designed for cleaning data. The first is a command called SQLite-utils-transform, which you can think of as basically a superpowered alter statement. So here what I'm going to do is I'm going to rename some columns. I've renamed lat to latitude and long to longitude. I'll change the type of that T-length column, which is the measured length of the manatee. I'll change that to a float from the text that it is now. I'll drop a few columns that I know aren't particularly interesting, and I'll reassign the primary key of that column to be the field ID column. So I'm going to paste this into my terminal and start dataset running again. And now when I refresh this page, you can see that we've cleaned up the data quite a lot. We've got a small number of columns. We've renamed latitude and longitude. We've got that new primary key. So this is already beginning to look quite a bit better. Let's do something about those dates. That's not my ideal date format. I like them to be ISO formatted. And for this, we're going to use another SQLite-utils command, SQLite-utils-convert. What this does is it lets you select one or more columns and then run a Python function against those columns. In this case, I'm going to use a built-in recipe called r.parseDateTime to transform those columns. So I run that, it churns away, and it applies that function to all 13,000 rows in the data. And now when I start dataset back up again, you can see that those dates have been converted and now in that ISO format that's somewhat easier to work with. Let's do one last thing here. I'm going to facet by decode, and then I'm going to facet by mortality. And you'll notice that these numbers are suspiciously similar. It looks like decode 1 corresponds with human-raised watercraft collision. All of these decodes are actually just numeric codes for these mortalities. So let's clean this data up further by extracting those out into a separate table. I'm going to extract these two columns from that locations table I'm going to rename mortality to name in the resulting table, and that resulting table is going to be called mortality like that. So I paste that in here, and now if I hit refresh on this table, it's giving me an error because I'm trying to facet by a decode column that no longer exists. But here we go. So now we have a new column called mortality ID, and you'll notice that these right here are hyperlinks through to a record in another table. I can go up to that table and see here they are. They've got their decodes and they've got their names. And data's smart enough to spot when a foreign key table has a column called name, and it will use that as the label on the hyperlink. And that works for faceting too. So this latitude and longitude column looks fun. Let's do something interesting with that. Datasette supports plugins, and if you go to the Datasette website and look at the plugins page, you'll see a list of 81 plugins that have been released for Datasette so far. I can search for map and see there are a few options for mapping plugins. This one here, Datasette Cluster Map, looks like it might be what we want. So I'm going to run dataset install dataset cluster map, and this goes ahead and installs that plugin. And now, when I run dataset again, the plugin has now kicked in. The plugin looks for the latitude and longitude columns, and if it finds them, it plots their data on a map. And I can actually load all 13,500 points and start seeing a pretty good indication of where it's dangerous to be a manatee just through clicking through and browsing that map on its own. And this also works with the facet. So if I click through to the human-related floodgate canal log, I can see a map of just those incidents that featured that cause of mortality. So we're doing pretty well. We started with a CSV file, we've turned it into a much cleaner database structure, and now we've got a visualization too. Let's share this with the rest of the world. And I'm going to deploy this using a serverless hosting program called Cloud Run by Google Cloud. And Cloud Run provides a very inexpensive way to run stateless web applications online. The word stateless is very important. Normally, you'd expect a database application to be full of state, but it turns out if your database is read-only, if it's a SQLite database file, you can literally package it up as part of that Docker container and deploy it directly to a serverless hosting provider. So I'm going to run Dataset Publish Cloud Run. I'm going to call the service manatees. I'm passing a little bit of metadata, and I'm going to tell it to install a couple of plugins as well, that cluster map plugin, but also the dataset GraphQL one. So I paste that in here, and it's going to package everything up into a Docker container, push that Docker container up to Google Cloud, then build the container, and they will then deploy it and assign a URL. And that normally takes about 60 to 70 seconds. At the end of that, it gives me a URL. I can pop that open. And here is our brand new manatees database with that extra metadata. Click through to locations, and I can see those locations on that map. And remember, we installed that GraphQL plugin. I can actually click on this cog here and access a GraphQL API for those locations. And this even goes as far as expanding those foreign key relationships, in this case, the mortality one, and nesting those together as part of that GraphQL query. So we now have a full-blown GraphQL API for the manatee carcass locations, in addition to the JSON API and the visual interface for exploring that data. So hopefully that gives you a good idea of the kind of tooling that I've been building here. I mentioned plugins earlier. As you saw, Datasette has over 80 plugins, providing all kinds of additional functionality through authentication, different ways of visualizing things, geospatial plugins that can do more complex things with geospatial data. But the other side of the Datasette project, these tools for creating these SQLite database files. I showed you sqlite-utils already. I also have a whole family of tools for converting other formats and APIs into SQLite. I've got GitHub to SQLite, which pulls down your data from GitHub about issues and issue comments and commits. Twitter to SQLite does the same thing with your Twitter data. And the goal here really is I'm trying to increase that range of things that can be represented as SQLite, partly so that you can use them with Datasette, but also because I think SQLite is a fantastic sort of interoperable standard for archiving and sharing data just on its own. The last trick I'll show you with Datasette is that you can also use it to build websites. In fact, dataset.io, the official website, is itself running on Datasette. Datasette allows you to set up custom templates. So I have a custom template for the homepage. It's got a database table here full of news, which is shown on the homepage. The entire thing is built out of this GitHub repository. Something I've been exploring a lot recently is this idea of using GitHub Actions to automate data processing and publishing. So every time I push a commit to the dataset.io repository, a script runs that builds all of these SQLite databases and then deploys them using Datasette Publish directly from this GitHub Actions workflow. I've been calling this the baked data architectural pattern. The key idea here is that for websites that don't change particularly often, content-oriented websites, you can bake a read-only copy of your data alongside the code of your application. You can deploy them as a single unit. As I mentioned earlier, serverless hosting providers like Cloud Run make this incredibly inexpensive, extremely robust, and they scale amazingly well because as you accept more traffic, you just spin up more instances. So I hope it piqued your interest. If you want to learn more, please hit the dataset.io website. If you want to talk to me about this stuff in person, I run a office hour sessions on a Friday where you're welcome to book a slot and we can have a conversation about what you can do with Dataset, but also things you might want to do that aren't possible yet, because I'm always looking for ways to expand out and improve the software.